Delilah.
It's the Tom Jones! Yay! Yay! The Tom!
Big time.
Well, this is the thing, Tom, because she's been right by you, hasn't she, for your entire career.
Yeah, that's...
You know, through some tough times, and there's been, you know, there's been a lot of talk, a lot of gossip.
Yeah.
Looking back now with this book, would you have done anything in your life differently?
Well, I can't say that, you know, because we're still here and Linda is still with me, you see. So, yeah. I mean, we're both Welsh. We have the same sense of humour. We're still in love with one another, you know. We fell in love as teenagers, you know, and we still feel that same way now. So she's been a part of my life all my life, really.
Yeah.
And she still is. So it's wonderful. So
Has she read the book, Tom?
She's reading it right now.
Wow.
But I read the end to her, first of all, because... because actually, you know, she realises that, you know, the way I feel about her, really.
Yeah.
So the book is testament to the way I feel. You know, the more I think about it, she's reading it as we speak in Los Angeles. Well, not as we speak, because she's sleeping now, it's back. But
she's partying, Tom.
She might be.
She might well be.
Yes. So she likes it, though. She's enjoying it.
That's brilliant. And Tom's autobiography, Over the Top and Back, and the companion album, Long Lost Suitcase, are available now.
Yes, and if you would like...
Wouldn't you know, to my mother, but... Uh-huh. And then my grandmother said, just a minute, so she had this cold water. I don't know whether it was a bucket or something. And she grabbed all of me by my ankles and dipped me in it and whipped me around like this.
Whoa!
You know, and I was like, ah! You know, and I,
yes!
Yeah!
Well, the book, amazingly, doesn't actually start there. It starts in Massachusetts, doesn't it, in Framingham?
Yeah.
In the mid to late 80s, when things weren't going so great for you. So why did you start it there, Tom?
Yeah, well, I wanted the people to understand, you know, that it wasn't smooth sailing from 65 until 2015. You know, there were sort of dips, but it wasn't... The public were always there. You see, when I would go on stage... But I wasn't realising it, but I was playing venues that I had no right to be in. You know, I was playing convention rooms in places, you know. Mm-hmm. And they'd have a wedding in the afternoon and then I would sing, you know, the entertainment at night. So I got a bit complacent, was the problem. And I wasn't concentrating on my recording career as much as I should have been.
This is in the 80s, Tom.
This was the 80s, yes. I was making some country records in the States and they were being sold in America and I was getting country hits.
Yeah.
But they weren't being sold anywhere else in the world, you see, and that was bothering me. So finally, you know, I recorded The Boy From Nowhere.
Yeah.
Eddie Segal and Mike Leander wrote this musical about El Cordobés and they asked me to do The Boy From Nowhere. So I did, and that got me back into the charts. In Britain especially, because I'd been longing to come back to Britain with a record, you know. And then the following year, of course, we did Kiss.
The Art of Noise. Went berserk, didn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
And talking of your amazing recording career, you're not a man to do things by halves, Tom. You've actually brought out, I should say, to be grammatically correct, you've brought out a CD to go with the autobiography.
Yes.
Long Lost Suitcase.
The Long Lost Suitcase,
which everyone's saying is raw, it's live, it's out there, it's loud, and it's you kind of doing your thing.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Well, it's like starting again. Because when I was in Wales, when I was singing in the pubs and clubs, I had a band then called the Senators.
Yeah.
And I was Tommy Scott, you know, because Tom Jones, you know, was like Jim Smith in... Anyway, so I was Tommy Scott, the Senators, and we used to play all these clubs. The boys are laughing. So I was playing these clubs, you know, and with a rhythm section like that, and we'd pick songs and we'd like, and we'd do them, you know, in pubs and that. Yeah. So it's like doing that again. Ethan said, you know, you got to get back to what you started doing.
Absolutely.
Loving the blues and gospel music, you know, and you know, like that, so.
And, Tom, we were just talking before we came on air about a moment that you absolutely love. We're going to see it right now. It's you with Jerry Lee Lewis.
Someday my journey will finish.
The Beaufort Male Choir from South Wales has been raising the roof since 1887. Their roots lie in the mining community, heritage they're still proud of. While sorting through their archives, Secretary Chris Evans found a copy of a remarkable diary.
It tells the story of a group of choristers from Beaufort who, at the height of the miners' strike in 1926, got on a train, ended up in Bristol, and sang on the streets to raise as much money as possible to buy leather to make shoes for destitute children.
The choir had seen families fall into poverty on the lead-up to the bitter strike. Determined to help, they embarked on a busking tour.
With no plan, no food, and nowhere to stay, they'd intended to simply live by their wits. Well, 89 years later, the current Beaufort Choir has decided to pay tribute to them by following in their footsteps. Good morning and welcome to Bristol! Yay! Are we ready to take to the streets?
We are. Yeah.
Men of Harlem in the hollow.
According to the diary, the street choir sang as many as 180 songs a day for almost 3 weeks in the hope of putting shoes on children's feet. A tough gig considering the choir were almost penniless themselves.
What was the public's attitude towards the cause?
Some people were incredibly generous, but there were others. And in the diary, there's a great story when they were busking outside a rich gentleman's house. At that moment, the master himself appeared on the scene, carrying a riding crop. Brandishing this, he said, "Clear off from here. You should be ashamed of yourselves. Why aren't you down the pit getting the coal out? Do you know I have 20 men idle through you miners?" To which the chairman of the choir replied, "It's a great wonder to me that you have 20 men working for you with a face like that."
I mean, that's funny, but they were really working in a highly charged atmosphere.
Certainly.
How much do you reckon you're going to make today?
I would be very happy if we clear £100, which will go to charity.
£100 is a lot.
Freedom, God and
Then the singers had to survive on handouts of food. To see what it felt like, today's choir tried to blag a free lunch from the nearby supermarket.
Is there any chance we can have a quiet word with the manager?
The presence of a TV crew probably makes it easier than it was in the 20s.
Bread and cheese. You guys are only doing this for one meal, but remember, those guys did it for, what, 19 days?
It's a humbling experience. You know, we're tired now, and we've only been in it 4 or 5 hours.
After a hard day's busking, the original choir faced the prospect of sleeping rough. But late one night, they found surprising hospitality at a boarding house that's now university property.
The door was opened by an elderly lady to whom he said, 14 miners from South Wales, can you put them up? It was a great disappointment when they said there was only one bed vacant. But they went on to say, "Ma, if you will only allow us to come in to sit on chairs or even on the floor. Anything, because we're just deadbeat." So
she went on to house all 14 of them.
Yeah.
Like, that would not happen these days.
Exactly. Yeah. It'd be on TripAdvisor, wouldn't it?
A lot of trust went on there.
Yeah.
What does it feel like to be walking in the steps of your predecessors?
Eerie.
Thrilled a bit.
You're probably singing, in you?
Yeah. I get the table then, do I?
I get the chair, thank you.
That's you, on the same floor.
Oh, this is a hard floor.
I'm not... How do you sleep on such like this?
He's got a carpet.
Trust me, this carpet is not comfortable.
After 19 days of busking, the choir had made the equivalent of £2,700. Back home, the Boot and Shoe Committee was extremely grateful. For today's choir, the trip back in time's coming to an end too.
Well, we've had a wonderful day. Today's experience has made me feel really privileged and to realise how easy we have it in society.
To see what those guys went through all those years ago, I'm going to have great respect for them.
Yes.
to go.